The 1971 Stanford Prison Experiment isn't what you think it is. A lot of things happened in 1971. There were 3 partial solar eclipses, 2 total lunar eclipses. The United States government unilaterally terminated the convertibility of the US dollar to gold, and Donald Trump took over the management of daddy's money. Clearly a busy year. But just 35 miles away from San Francisco, tucked in the basement of a lab in Stanford University's Jordan Hall, something else was going on. The Stanford Prison Experiment. It's been more than 50 years, and yet the mythos of this scientific farce lives on. It's no doubt a good story, so good they even made it into a film. Not one, not two, not three, but 4 films. About how ordinary and innocent people can be transformed by circumstance into willing tyrants, freely abusing their powers to commit horrors and atrocities. It's a clear and simple message. Power corrupts even the best of us. But the Stanford Prison Experiment is a good story, built on a foundation of bullshit. This is the story of psychology's greatest farce. If you were a scientist trying to get away with bad science, how would you go about it? Having studied a ton of bad scientists doing bad science, I can tell you with some degree of confidence that it all comes down to just one simple trick. It's all about narrative. Let me explain. This man over here is Philip Zimbardo, the Stanford Prison Experiment's lead scientist. This is what he had to say in a 2009 interview. And so my sympathies were heavily with prisoners. I was anti-prisons, anti-corrections, etc. Okay, so am I. Still, a scientist doesn't design an experiment to push some kind of agenda, even if this agenda is a good agenda. Good or bad, Zimbardo had an agenda. For his experiments, Zimbardo recruited 24 healthy male college students. The students were divided into 2 groups. There were the guards and the prisoners. The basement of the Stanford University's Jordan Hall was converted into a mock prison environment over the summer break, with the expectation that the experiment would last for 2 weeks. The planned 2 weeks ended up being just 6 days. The research team pulled the plug on the experiment 6 days in to safeguard the welfare of the prisoners, or so they told us. According to Zimbardo and company, his experiment had transformed 12 ordinary college students into tyrannical prison guards. All it took, 6 days. And a little meddling on Zimbardo's part. You see, Philip Zimbardo, the lead scientist, the man in charge of this experiment, joined in on the fun, assigning himself the role of prison superintendent. During the experiment's 6 short days, Zimbardo would berate the prison guards daily, instructing them that they should toughen up and treat the prisoners more aggressively.
I love you, Jordan.
You smile, Jordan, please. You get down here and do 10 push-ups.
John Mark, one of the guards, refused to play along. During the simulation, John even asked the researchers if he could join the prisoners, but was told he could not. Reluctantly, he showed up to his shifts, but never led the count, never barked orders, never engaged in sarcasm. Instead of toughening up, John brought the prisoners extra fruit and cigarettes when on shift. According to John Mark, Zimbardo went out of his way to create tension and often coached or manipulated the guards into being cruel. So did the 11 other guards crack?
No.
No. The majority, 8 out of the 12 guards, were just like John. They did not show any sadistic tendencies. Zimbardo had failed to turn them into tyrants. Only 4 of the 12 guards abused their power at any point during the experiment. And I wish I could say that this is where all the bullshit ended. David Eshelman was one of the 4 guards who would play along. In fact, by all accounts, he was the worst of the lot. The prisoners even nicknamed him John Wayne for his imaginative cruelty. So much of the conclusions of the Stanford Prison Experiment are based on just this one guard.
It's my nature to be obedient,
Mr. Virginia.
You would lie. You would stink lie.
And before I told you to get down on that floor and fuck the floor, what would you do then?
David Eshelman, aka John Wayne. Seems a little bit specific. Like, I don't know, but I smell something fishy. So you're telling me that David Eshelman earned himself a very specific nickname given to him by the prisoners in just 6 days? 6 days? I mean, nicknames are a thing, but people don't just acquire them in 6 days.
It's unbelievable.
So it turns out that nickname John Wayne wasn't some weird organic happenstance. David Eshelman was a drama student at Chapman University. When he was assigned to be a guard, he took the experiment seriously, very seriously. So seriously that Eshelman watched a 1967 film, Cool Hand Luke, where an evil prison warden torments his prisoners.
I just watched a movie called Cool Hand Luke, and the mean, intimidating, southern prison warden character in that film really was my inspiration for the role that I created for myself.
This explains why he earned the nickname John Wayne in 6 days. It wasn't because he was unimaginably cruel, it was because Eshelman was trying to act out a movie from which he was playing a character. That's what drama students do, I suppose. Far from proving anything about human nature, the Stanford Prison Experiment's only real conclusion is a really, really simple one. David Eshelman probably deserves an Oscar for his performance. Even more so because according to one prisoner, prisoner 8612, the prison felt phony. Much like its lead scientist, Philip Zimbardo. On the final day of the study, on August 21st, 1971, and before he had the chance to look over any findings from his so-called experiment, Zimbardo sent a press release to local and national newsletters. In it, he declared that history had been made and that the Stanford Prison Experiment was a clear message for prison reform. In October 1971, Zimbardo testified before Congress. The topic? Prison reform. In his testimony, Zimbardo said that the guards were given no specific instructions and left free to make up their own rules for maintaining law, order, and respect. He said the experience of imprisonment undid, although temporarily, a lifetime of learning. Human values were suspended, self-concepts were challenged, and the ugliest, most base, pathological side of human nature surfaced. Zimbardo lied, and he kept on lying. In November 1971, he released a feature article for Time magazine and a video for NBC. You know what he didn't do? Publish a peer-reviewed research paper on his study. The research paper would only come in 1973, at which point I suppose hardly mattered anymore. The lie had been told over and over again, rendering the facts irrelevant. Good stories do that, and this was a good story told by a master storyteller. So I've recently found myself thinking about the power of narrative a lot. I like science a lot. I like science so much. I talk about it to you guys in these videos. So I feel a weird sense of anxiety when I see how the power of narrative can triumph over science. Science is powerful. It's the most powerful thing out there. But even the best science fails when put against the seductive story told by a charming charlatan. It shouldn't be this way, but I guess it just is. My name is Hashim, and this is my YouTube channel. Thanks for watching.